Hello everybody, welcome back to the channel for another live stream, a Friday live stream, which I think might be a first. So this is just going to be another Primo Pic live stream like the ones that we've been doing for however long it is now, because there wasn't one last Sunday because I was in London for the BFI Revelation of the Daleks screening. So I thought I'd do another one tonight instead, and then we'll see after that, you know, when the next one will be. But yeah, I always give people a moment to arrive and to tune in. If you are watching, do let me know in the chat that you're here. So tonight we will be going through Series 5 Primo Pics and nostalgia and stuff, because yeah, at the end of the last Primo Pic stream, we reached the end of Series 4 and the specials. We didn't actually do End of Time in the last stream. I was going to start the next stream with that, but then I kind of just thought to myself, you know, let's just have a clean start and just do 11th Doctor stuff, you know, in this stream today. Let's start off afresh with Series 5, and then maybe come back to End of Time somewhere along the line a bit later on. But yeah, for the purposes of today, we are just going to be skipping ahead into Series 5, the start of the Matt Smith era, and just looking at some Series 5 Primo Pics, going through some Series 5 nostalgia, because it was a pretty amazing time for Doctor Who back in 2010. So yeah, that's the plan for the stream, and we will just sort of go for, I don't know, maybe not quite as long as the streams have tended to be recently, maybe just like for an hour and a half or something, I don't know. We'll see how we go. Probably, you know, aiming to cover like the first half of the series and then to come back to it, like the final sort of 6 or 7 episodes in another stream, whether that be on Sunday or next week or whenever. So I will just give people a moment to join, just in case there's anybody else that wants to join. And I thought, you know, for the first sort of 5 or 10 minutes or so, just to sort of have a bit of a sort of warm up before the main events, we would head over to this, the Dalek Colour Scheme Creator, which we stumbled upon in a previous stream. I don't know when it was, like at some point maybe when we're doing the Series 4 stuff or Series 3 or whatever. So this is on the Doctor Who site, here, the merchandise one. Hang on, is it cropped out? Let me just fix that. I think in this new layout, the top of that has got a bit cropped out. So let's just have a look. Bring it down slightly. There we go. There you can see now the Doctor Who site there at the top. Yeah, brilliant sites. They do great stuff, particularly for the merchandise. If I can find it, there we go. The merchandise guide. They do all sorts of amazing stuff on here. They have been doing for years, actually, as it happens, you know, all the way back. If we go to the archive and like the very last page, I mean, well, okay, these aren't real pages, these ones here, 1963. Clearly the site wasn't going in 1963, but like if we skip ahead a few pages, you know, there'll be stuff from like 2008, 2009. Let me just find what I'm looking for. Find some stuff from 2010, that's the aim basically. We'll skip ahead a couple of pages. 2007, okay, maybe to like, I don't know, here. Yeah, we go 2009, a few more pages ahead. Still in 2009, okay. 2010, yeah, here we go. All this this merch that came out around this time. Let's have a look. Yeah, Doctor Adventures with that cover when Matt became the Doctor and all this sort of stuff. So yeah, they've been documenting the merchandise on this site for a long time. Yeah, all the way back to the era which we're revisiting today and further. So if I can just find the page I was on, here we go, the Dalek Colour Scheme Creator. Yeah, this is one of a sort of a number of features or games or whatever that they did back in the day. So this was like to coincide with Victory of the Daleks coming out, I think. And yeah, basically a lot of the games they did, like a lot of platform games, are sadly no longer available to play. If we just very, very briefly try and find the page which they're on. Oh, hang on, not that one. Doctor Who sites. Features and games. Yeah, things like this. They did a little game about Wars of Mars, one about Victory of the Daleks, where you could like be a Dalek and shoot down tanks and stuff. There was this one here where you could create your own Cyberman design. But all of these, like because of Flash or whatever changing in recent years, all of these aren't able to play anymore. One about the Planet of the Dead bus there, one about the next Doctor and the Cybermen and Dalek stuff. All sorts of bonkers things. Sarah Jane Adventures Slug Invasion, one about the canine Australian series, one about the Doctor Who reindeer idents that they had for Christmas 2008 or whenever it was. Absolutely mad. But yeah, the one that does still work is this Dalek colour scheme creator. So I thought, just to get us into the spirit of things, we would do a couple of these. But let's just see who is in the chat. Hooniverse Archive, hello, great to have you with us. Of course, the person behind the fantastic Black Archive site, which we'll be going to very shortly. But for now, let's just head back to this. We have Dr. Master. Oh my god, my horrible day is saved. I'm glad to save your horrible day. Glad to save it. It's my pleasure. Hooven Special Extra, hello. Emily Ashley, hello. Owen Duckers, hello. Buster Block, great to have you all with us. Ben Miller. Dr. Master says, Richard Lloyd, how many likes to get you to sniff the TARDIS bubble bath? I mean, it would take quite a few for me to open that, because it's a sort of piece of pristine, nostalgic merchandise from back in the day. So, I don't know. It's tempting, but I'm going to set the bar high, you know, and say, I don't know, if this stream got to like 50 likes, then maybe I'd do it, but it's not going to happen, is it? Or if I got like a £1,000 super chat, then I would do it. There we go. We've got a few questions, so I will go over questions as we just do a couple of these Daleks. So I think the first one I had is from Ben Miller, who says, which recurring monster slash villain from the classic era would you like to see make a return in the future? So obviously the big one that we've had recently, obviously, is the Sea Devils, which we never really thought we were going to get. And now we're just on the verge of getting them sort of next month in the Easter special. Hold on, how's this work? Oh, there we go. We can select a colour. So yeah, I think for a lot of people, for many years, they were at the top of the list, really. I know a lot of people have sort of said, like, the Yetis as well are like the sort of last big bad from the classic era to come back. We sort of had it with the Great Intelligence coming back, but I think people still want to see the Yeti again. Yeah, I guess. I think thinking a bit more outside the box, what could I say to that? I mean, I'm trying to think in terms of different eras. I don't know, really. Maybe, like, we've had all the big hitters. We've had Zygons, haven't we? We've had some Taurons, obviously, and Daleks and Cybermen and stuff. So, who's up on the figure shelf that I could take some inspiration from? Let's have a look. How about the Fendal? That springs to mind. Or the Robots of Death. But then again, they're a bit boring, aren't they? And like Syl is another answer, but then he's quite a sort of Sixth Doctor villain, like specific to the Sixth Doctor. So I don't know, really. A few answers there. Clack of the Geek says hello. Hello, Clack of the Geek. And hello, H. Zoisa. However you say that, apologies. So what are we thinking here for colour schemes? I mean, there was never a green paradigm Dalek, was there? So that was kind of my thinking here, I think, just sort of subconsciously to do a green one. So if we change the sort of headpiece as well, I mean, there can be different colours. You can have, like, you know, red or just whatever. You can have all these different parts and different colours. Purple, that'd be quite cool, actually. A purple paradigm Dalek. That'd be quite neat. But I feel like it would have to be sort of a bit of a darker shade, maybe. Like that. That's a nice shade, actually, for a paradigm. Like a metallic, glittery purple, like shiny purple. That'd be nice. Oh, yes, the Rani. We've got a couple of suggestions there about the Rani. Yes, I would love to see the Rani. And if we're sort of including, like, you know, humanoids and villains and stuff, and not just creatures, monsters, aliens and stuff, the Rani would be so amazing. Yeah, I mean, I was sort of saying that, I was just thinking this earlier, actually, that today I was thinking that prior to Flux starting, I was sort of, well, I didn't have it in my head, but I was sort of trying to wish into existence the fact that Roshanda Sandal would play the Rani, because obviously we found out she was going to be in Flux. She ended up playing Azure, but yeah, she'd have been a great Rani, I think, if she hadn't been playing that other role instead of Azure. Yeah, but let's just finish off this purpley Dalek, I guess, because the fun thing about this as well is you can change the basically any part of the Dalek, so you can change the sort of the bumps as well, for want of a better word. So they can be like bright green. So that reminds me of Doctor Adventures and their like branding and stuff. I'm pretty sure that's like purple and green these days, isn't it? So that's fun. Or like blue. And change the midsection as well, a gun bit. There we go, that bit's... I mean, it's a very fun thing, this. I haven't used it in years. I used to use it back in the day. I used to use all these games back in the day, you know. They were very fun. But yeah, just a bit of nonsense, really, to get us into the swing of things. Let's have as many colours on here as possible. So, which bits haven't I done it? The eye stalk. The eye stalk could be like orange, I guess, maybe. The lights, we can do the lights as well. They could be like red, I guess. We've done the head. This bit, the rings, they could be like, what haven't we had yet? A yellow, I guess. There we go. Oh, crikey, that's bright. Those bits, what colour haven't we had yet? We blue, purple, pink, green, red, orange, yellow. That's all the main ones, right, isn't it? Pink. Like a dark blue, maybe, for those bits. And then I think that just leaves the base, which, yeah, is black. Let's leave that black, because I can't think of anything else to do with it. There we go. A lovely multicoloured Dalek there. Just to sort of get us into the swing of things for tonight's stream. But yeah, let's put that to a side. Put that to one side even for a moment and head over to the Black Archive. Of course, this is the main event. We're going to be going through all the promo pics from the first half of Series 5, at least the officially released ones. I'm going to be copying them across to my own personal archive and just going through them one by one, really, and we'll sort of reminisce about which ones are nostalgic or which ones, you know, have never been seen before, the rarely seen gems. I know there are one or two from having a sneak peek already, one or two that sort of I'd never seen before at all. So we will do that. So if I can just get myself sorted out. I saw us in the chat, we've got Pete Adamson. Hello, Pete, great to have you here. Amin says, I remember using this as a kid just to see what the Imperial Dalek colours would look like on the new series models. I really loved that colour scheme as a child. Oh, interesting. Yeah, it's great for sort of mixing up the designs and the colours and stuff. And yeah, maybe that's something to try later in the stream or on another stream, maybe sort of applying other Dalek colour schemes to the wrong model and seeing how that works out. So, without further ado, let's go on to the main events of tonight, the Series 5 promotional pictures. So, Series 5. I mean, what a time this was. It was my first era where I was there from the start, so I saw it through, you know, all the way from the start to the end. I was there for, well, just going straight in from the bat, all this this weird stuff here where it was like the sort of limbo, the limbo stage between Ten leaving and Matt Smith joining, obviously. I actually need to make myself some folders here. Bear with me one moment. Yes, there was a lot of stuff like this around that time, where it was like these sort of strange promo pics where you sort of see the characters, see the Doctor, sort of not quite fully formed yet. You know, like this image here is one that went round a lot. And it's a weird one to look back on because, like, that's sort of the 11th Doctor, but also not quite. Like, it doesn't quite look right. And it also looks like he's holding a torch because of that lens flare rather than his sonic screwdriver, which, of course, he is holding. But, yeah, that in particular is a very nostalgic photo there. And it's interesting as well, like, to think about this changeover between Doctors, I think, looking back, because I think since it's happened, like in the years since, a lot has been said about how the BBC was sort of like, what, not on the verge of cancelling Doctor Who, but they were sort of thinking, oh God, how are we going to continue this show after David Tennant has left because he was so massively popular? And so a lot has been said, I think, over the years since, yeah, about basically what was going on at the time and sort of how much was resting on this changeover, you know, being successful and going right. And I think it's a miracle that it did go as well as it did, really. You know, because certainly from when I was a kid watching this, like age 9 or 10, you know, I didn't really bat an eyelid that, you know, the Doctor had changed and everything had changed. It was just all so exciting and amazing. And yeah, obviously with the merchandise as well. I mean, there was still a lot of merchandise for Matt's first year and not so much for the second and third years, you know. I mean, things changed quite a bit in terms of merchandise and I think how the show was perceived from the beginning of Matt's time, you know, to the end, when you think about like the 5th anniversary and the sort of, I suppose, the sort of shift towards a more like, you know, fan-based audience, you know, with things like casting Peter Capaldi and stuff and all the sort of stuff that was going on by the 5th anniversary, like Asylum of the Daleks and Every Dalek Ever and all that sort of stuff. And yeah, but yeah, it's an interesting one. It's an interesting one, Matt Smith, though. It's such an interesting beast, really, in terms of how that shift occurred. Because yeah, there was quite a shift, I think. But yeah, just thinking back to the start of it, I mean, it was a magical time. So many memories, you know, looking back at these photos. And yeah, I mean, what can I say? This sort of like blue wormhole, and these little bubbles with like the Smiler in and the Dalek and Weeping Angel and stuff. Absolutely amazing. Really, really nostalgic. And, you know, Series 5 does still stand up to scrutiny, I think. It really does. It's a really great season. Yeah, I would still say so. I mean, this is the photo here that was everywhere. Like the first proper promotional picture we had for Series 5. Always interesting. In fact, hold on, is there another variation of this somewhere? Let me just double check. Because I swear, maybe I remembered that wrong. I swear Amy's hair was in a ponytail. Maybe not. Maybe I've always just looked at that and thought it was a ponytail, but never looked close enough. Maybe it wasn't a ponytail then. Fair enough. Yeah, but anyway, this photo, oh boy, yeah, what a photo. It was such an exciting time. I mean, you got your sort of three big bads from the early episodes of the season there, like I say, you know, the Smiler, the Weeping Angels, and the Daleks. I remember the Weeping Angels being a big sort of part of the promotion for early Series 5. Like, the Weeping Angels are back, and obviously the Daleks as well, and... Yeah, I think with the Smilers as well, with these boys, you know, like it was, because they were sort of so central in bits of promotional stuff like this, you could be forgiven for sort of thinking at the time, oh, this might be like a massive, big, new monster. And it's literally just like something that appears in the second episode of the series and then is never seen again, you know. But yeah, I remember there being speculation about that, speculation as well about the trailer, the Down the Rabbit Hole trailer, which obviously that promo pic ties into, and the whole thing where at the end we had this massive face like sort of exploding out of the ground, and of course it was the new Silurian mask. That was hugely exciting. Because I think really, like, thinking back and looking back, I think this is sort of the last time where, like, in the show's history to date, I think it's the last time where it was sort of really sort of aimed at kids, I guess, in terms of the show. Like, it was the last sort of time where that formula for the first, like, four series of the revival was used, I guess. Because obviously with Series 6, you had the shift to the more, like, international audience with going over to America and stuff. You sort of get, again, a bit in Series 7 as well, like the last hurrah for the sort of boyfriend-girlfriend sort of doctor-companion relationship with the 11th Doctor and Clara. But then, yeah, everything we've had sort of since Doctor and Clara and Doctor and Amy is a slightly different type of doctor-companion relationship, and I think as well, you know, relates to that, a slightly different way of the show sort of presenting itself to the world and different audiences and stuff. And yeah, I think, like I say, this is the last time sort of that it was kind of very explicitly aimed at young kids, really. I mean, I know it has been since as well, of course, and like the Jodie stuff and the Capaldi stuff, not quite so much. Yeah, but I mean, maybe it's just nostalgia again, but I remember, you know, as a young boy myself watching this, it was just amazing, and it really ticked all those boxes, you know, for what you would want from Doctor Who, as like a 9-year-old kid watching it. So yeah, I think when I think about, well, like what I would do with Doctor Who if I was in charge, or like just even, you know, different approaches to it, you know, that could be taken in future, this is like a sort of a benchmark for me, this era. In terms of the magic, in terms of the way it captured my imagination and loads of kids' imaginations, it was really awesome. Let us just see what the chat is saying. Owen, I never knew that wasn't a torch. Yeah, sorry to break it to you there. Wow, Hooven Espresso Extra still has some of these images as posters on their wall. It's fantastic. Good for you. Amazing. Yeah, Paul Android. Hello, Paul. Great to have you here. Been loving your covers and stuff recently. The pilot one and everything. The one from like the Series 3 finale. Yeah, everyone go in the chat. Go and check out Paul's channel for those. They're fantastic. But yeah, Paul's saying it's a shame that the Time Vortex, we were just looking at a sort of wormhole-y one, never actually appeared in the show. Yeah, it is a shame, isn't it? It was sort of in a lot of the promotional stuff, but it was never sort of like officially... In fact, here it is again, in this image here, with the crack in the background. Yeah, it was never in the show properly, which was a bit of a shame, really. I mean, I guess the closest we got was like in Twice Upon a Time, the vortex they had there, just for that episode where it had two TARDISes like going through the vortex. That was quite similar in concept to that one. This is a rare image as well. I have seen it before. I don't know whether it's like from a specific magazine's photo shoot, maybe. Like, was it what's it called? SFX? No, what's it called? SFX. Yeah, that's the one. That magazine, the science fiction magazine. Was it for them, maybe? Or like a newspaper or something? I don't know. But it's a cool image. A very strange image, actually, with all the flowers and stuff. Because, like, what's going on here? Like, this wasn't an episode in Series 5. But nevertheless, very nice. We have got Will Newlands in the chats with us. Currently my one and only channel member. Hello, Will. Great to have you here. Will says, my Series 5 and Series 18 Blu-rays arrived today. Oh, cool. So, hang on. Do you mean the Season 18 collection box set? Do you mean the limited edition one or the standard edition? And Series 5, do you mean the steelbook of this series, presumably, or standard edition or whatever? Let us know in the chats. In fact, I do remember this one as well, this image. This was a big double spread in the Radio Times the week that the 11th Hour went out. And yeah, looking back, it's a bit rough around the edges and stuff in terms of the composition and stuff. But it's still really cool, like, you know, with one half sort of the Doctor and Amy and the Weeping Angel and, like, the Doctor's regenerated and he's all, you know, in his stride and stuff. And then on the right-hand side, obviously, like, the sort of the proto-11th Doctor, where he's just regenerated from the 10th Doctor and he's still sort of working himself out, and Amy's there as well. So the two sides, which I really loved, you know, like the sort of post-regeneration sort of bits and then the sort of proper hit the ground running, you know, we're in the swing of things now, half as well. Yeah, really, really love that image. It's absolutely fantastic. What a great one. So nostalgic. All right, Will says, it was the limited edition Season 18 for £30. All right, the original release, that's pretty good. And Series 5 is the original release. Fair enough. A couple more bits from Will. Let's have a look. Will says, thoughts on the Old Friends box set. So that's from the 9th Doctor Adventures Series 1. For me, it was a great finale to the first season. Well, I haven't actually got around to listening to it yet. I haven't actually listened to the majority of the third volume of Ninth Doctor stories yet. I've listened to like one of them, and that was only like last week. I am very behind, but I have got them, and I am slowly getting around to listening to them. I am very excited to listen to Old Friends because, you know, obviously of the massive Cyberman reveal, the fact that they're in it, and of course the Brigadier as well. Yeah, very much looking forward to that set. I mean, when that trailer came out from Big Finish with the reveal of the Cybermen being in the set, I was like, oh my god, I was already excited for this box set, but now it is like an absolute must listen. And, you know, I've heard from people like yourself saying how good it is, so, you know, I have no doubts that it will be amazing. The sort of the big Cyberman finale that the Ninth Doctor never got and always deserved. So yeah, I'm very much looking forward to that, just sort of savouring a bit, I guess, inadvertently. And Will is also saying, which figure set did your 5th Doctor figure from season 21 come from? I need it in my life. So if you mean from my Instagram post, let's do a cheeky little Instagram plug. Ooh, that's on point, isn't it? Wow, a lovely Pandorica image there. Let's give it a like. Very on brand for our Series 5 theme stream. Yeah, this account, Who Photography, is absolutely phenomenal. They do some amazing stuff. I mean, look at that. Absolutely amazing. Go and follow this guy. But yeah, if we just head over, I assume you mean the one that I posted here, this photo, this 5th Doctor. Yes, that was the one from the 11 Doctors set, technically from The Awakening, which is obviously the next story after Horrors of the Deep, so it's not quite right. I think, pardon me, I think he got like a new jumper or something in the Awakening, didn't he? So that's why it's a variant. But yeah, it's a very nice figure, and is available, like I say, either in the 13 Doctors set or individually on eBay if you're lucky. But yeah, please go follow me on Instagram if you haven't already. I have just noticed on my phone, Sunny Witt has just started following me, which is fantastic. Great to have you join us. But anyway, off topic, let's go back to Series 5 promo picks and see what else the chat has been saying. Even Espresso Extra thinks it was the cover of TV Guide or something, the big flowery photo, and suggests that yes, it could have been like a sort of spring or Easter thing, because obviously these episodes went out around that time of year. Yeah, fair enough. What else have we got? We've got Cameron Cadona in the chat. Hello. Yeah, Cameron says, this is when I made it. This was when I was growing up in high school. So many memories. Yeah, absolutely. It was an amazing time, wasn't it? So good. So good. We have got some more chat about the Ninth Doctor adventures, the Ordered Adventures. So Emily says, Old Friends is my favourite of the Ninth Doctor audios so far. High praise indeed. And Will says, Fragmotif was my favourite of the season. Okay, yeah. I think for me, like, the first and second sets were sort of okay. I think my favourite out of all of them was Girl Deconstructed, so the first story of the second set. But yeah, I'm expecting that to change with the final set. You know, I really am hoping I like it and expecting to like the big Cyberman story. Fingers crossed, when I eventually get around to listening to that. And apparently Human Special Extra has also done a Series 5 post today, presumably on Instagram, I believe. So clearly it's a Series 5 kind of day. We've got Mono Supreme in the chat as well. Hello, Oscar, or Aussie Mono Supreme. Great to have you. Thanks for the nice compliment there. Thank you. I've just paused on this a minute because this is a particularly nostalgic thing for me. In fact, is that a real QR code there? I'm just trying to see if that still works. Oh wow, it does. It comes up with add Doctor Who to contacts. Alright, it's literally like add Doctor Who to contacts, and it just comes up with like the web address for the Doctor Who homepage. Okay, interesting. Yeah, but basically, does anyone else remember? Before I say, does anybody else remember where this poster came from? I've sort of given away the answer there by doing the QR code thing. But basically it was a thing that appeared on the Doctor Who website, the official website, like straight after the 11th Hour had been on. Back when they actually like put effort into stuff like this, you know, doing like extra content for the episodes and stuff, like a lovely little an image there. And I think as well they did like a version of the To Victory poster from Victory of the Daleks as well, which maybe we might stumble upon when we get to Victory of the Daleks. I don't know if we've got it on the website, but yeah, gotta love this, absolutely fantastic stuff. So that is the wanted poster for Prisoner Zero. But in terms of the episode itself and the actual episode stills here, let's just get straight into it. A lot of stuff from, well, sort of two main parts of the episode, like the early stuff with Amelia, and then the later stuff in Ledworth as well. I've got Matt Smith there sporting a new piece of headwear. Great shot there of Amelia. Yeah, I remember that one from back in the day. And then of course these iconic shots of Matt there sort of eating his bacon, or rather refusing to eat his bacon indeed. Hmm. bad beans. I mean, it is such a great way to introduce your new doctor. And obviously, it's something that went over my head a bit at the time. But, you know, obviously hearing people like Stephen Moffat say since that it was very deliberate the way this scene and this sort of opening to the episode happened. Yeah, I mean, it's just genius. In the sense that, like, you know, the doctor crashes into a kid's back garden or a front garden or whatever. And obviously it's like influenced by, I think, the character of Tiger in Winnie the Pooh or something like that, I think. Yeah, it's very deliberate in the sense that, like, obviously, you know, who does a new doctor need to win over more than anybody else? The kids at home watching. So what do? You have him literally crash land into the garden of, you know, a kid, just like the kids watching at home, and you have him sort of just be all like charming and just like, you know, sort of earn their trust, I guess, which is a really clever way to do it. And then you have Amy all grown up and she's the companion, and it all works out so nicely. And it's obviously riffing on stuff like Girl in the Fireplace as well, or still Stephen Moffat tales of, you know, the Doctor meeting someone at one point in their life and then meeting them at a later point or an earlier point or whatever. But it works so well. And I love the aesthetic as well in this episode of Ladworth as well, as a country little village. I love how much green there is in this episode, like of the green of the lawn and the bushes and stuff. A very sort of idyllic little setting for this new Doctor's first story. Quite reminiscent as well, looking back, of stuff like Spearhead from Space in that regard, because obviously there's a hospital as well, which the Doctor gets his new clothes from. So, yeah, I mean, all round, a really great opening episode, I would say, for Matt. I mean, I guess there are a couple of things maybe, like, that, I don't know, like, Prisoner Zero is a pretty cool villain, but he's not, like, top tier, is he? But I suppose he does the job for the episode. Like, you don't want to bring in, like, the Daleks for the opening episode and then just have them out of the way, you know, play that card now and then not be able to use it again in a couple of episodes' time. Very iconic shot there of Rory. I mean, this was weird as well, how... I don't know if at the time, you know, because obviously I was like 9 years old. I don't know how much was known when the 11th Hour went out about the role that Rory would go on to play in the rest of the series. And the fact that he would sort of basically become like a second companion. But to me, as a 9 year old, that just never was on my radar whatsoever. I don't know, maybe if like on the forums and stuff, maybe people had worked it out. Maybe people had sort of seen Arthur Darvill was back in later filming blocks and stuff. But yeah, literally watching this first episode going out, literally for me, it was a case of, oh, okay, he's a nice character, but we're probably not going to see him again much. And then, yeah, obviously he like goes on to play probably an even bigger part sort of in this era than even Stephen Moffat I didn't envisage it at the time, or even Arthur Darvill. I mean, it's weird to look at him there and think this guy, like, you know, leaves the TARDIS a couple of seasons later in Angels Take Manhattan, and he has all these adventures and does all this stuff and becomes a Roman Auton and a Centurion, all this sort of stuff, and does all this heroic stuff, blowing up cyber legions and stuff like that. It's bonkers, really. But there we go. Yeah, I mean, Rory, what a fantastic character. Got to love him. Where were we up to? I think we're up to this one here. Yeah, quite a few photos for this episode, aren't there? Oh, Cameron's saying it was the tiger that came for tea that... the Doctor Amy stuff was inspired by... okay, yeah, fair enough. I don't think it was a Winnie the Pooh thing. Yeah, it was that, wasn't it? Thank you for that. Thanks for clarifying. We've got some chat as well about fish fingers and custard. Now look, has anybody in the chat tried fish fingers and custard? I know that Hoover Espresso Extra has, because they've already confessed to trying it with their friend once. I mean, I will kick things off and say that yes, of course, I have tried it. Well, I say that. I'm not sure I've ever actually like properly done it properly, like, you know, actual fish fingers and actual custard. I think, like, because my school, where I was at the time, used to do, like, obviously, like, fish and chips Friday sort of thing. But it wasn't actual fish or actual fish fingers even. It was, like, fish cakes, pretty sure. So I think I did, like, fish cakes and custard quite a few times just to sort of see how that tasted. That was, like, my first experience of it. And then I think since then, I might have done like a more proper actual fish fingers thing with custard, but certainly not for a while. Not in recent years. Not at all. Emily's saying that one of her childhood friends was a Rory superfan who was very disappointed that it took so long for him to get an action figure. Yeah, that was annoying, wasn't it? It was annoying that, like, your Rory figure only came along after he'd left the TARDIS in 2012. That was really annoying. It was just such a weird thing with him, how he just sort of came out of nowhere and just, like, emerged as a companion. Like I say, you know, like, for me, watching it as a kid, I had no idea that there were going to be two companions. I just thought it was going to be Amy Pond and that was it, you know, the 11th Doctor and Amy, and you were sorted. But no, Rory came along as well, and sort of, obviously, he like sort of came and went a couple of times and went off and died and then came back. But yeah, he did end up sort of being, I guess, sort of by accident a bit maybe, but he did sort of end up being a proper companion. And yeah, it was just sort of a shame, I guess, just by virtue of the fact that he wasn't like the main companion and he wasn't part of the marketing from the start. By virtue of that, they didn't make a figure of him straight away because I guess he wasn't sort of deemed as important a character as Amy. But he definitely was by the end of his time on the show. Well, maybe not quite as important, but like nearly as important. I think, you know, Amy still is like the, out of the two, the one that has that special relationship because of that first scene, you know, when she was 7 years old, whatever, when she was the first face the 11th Doctor saw. You know, that was a special bond there, which Rory hasn't quite got the same thing. But nevertheless, he was there from the start. So there we go. I'm just thinking as well, that this probably would have been my first exposure to Olivia Colman as well in this episode. And obviously, like, nowadays, you see her everywhere you look. Like, in every film, every television program, you know, she is there. Yeah, mad. This was like relatively early on in her career, and you know, the things she's gone on to do since, bonkers. And to think that, you know, she was in Matt Smith's first episode of Doctor Who before she went to do all that other amazing stuff. Mad. On the subject of fish fingers and custard then, so, yeah, Human Express Factory says it wasn't actually that bad. I remember it not being too bad myself when I tried it, or sort of tried versions of it. But yeah, a couple of people in chat still need to try it, still want to try it. We have also got some chat about the rumours at the time, which I've got to be honest, like, well, I sort of remember them, but not properly. But the rumours that Rory was the master. Oh boy. Yeah, so to be fair, I don't think these rumours were around quite this far back. I think it took a little while, like maybe, you know, a year, like by 2011. That was when the rumours have started to appear, I think. I don't think they're around during Series 5, but I could be wrong. But yeah, the rumour was, obviously, that Rory was the Master. And I particularly remember this sort of being a thing, like, in the run-up to, like, the 50th anniversary, I think. Like, oh, it's going to be unveiled that Rory is the Master. Yeah, and obviously never happened. Bizarre. What else can you say? Yeah. But yeah, if anyone else remembers that, then do feel free to say. I think the majority of these are screen grabs, aren't they? Like that one there. That's quite a good one, actually, there, of Prisoner Zero. And there's a couple more right down the bottom here. A nice big portrait ones. Well, here we go. This dude with his dog. Matt there in the hospital. And then that one's a crack. Yeah, so that is all of the 11th hour. Oh, and there's a couple of behind the scenes photos as well from this one, I think. Well, okay, I'll say a couple. There's quite a few. There's loads of photos from this story, aren't there? Yeah, very, very interesting to look back at these, to think how early on it was. During Matt's time as the Doctor, you know. All those lights as well. I mean, my goodness, you don't really think about it when you're watching the scenes, but yeah, there's quite a few big lights there, out of shot. Amy's saying there that Rory's daughter was part-time Lord. Yeah, to be fair, I guess that is correct. Oh my god. Absolutely bonkers. I mean, there were so many rumours like that back in the day. And some spoilers and things that leaked from filming, like, way more than you get these days. There was, like, a proper sort of culture around Doctor Who filming, like, particularly around, like, Series 6 in particular, I guess, but sort of Series 5 as well a bit. Because, I mean, I remember seeing photos, like, filming photos from all this stuff in Ledworth, which is actually filmed in Llandaff in Cardiff. But yeah, I remember like seeing filming photos from the tabloids and stuff of like the ice cream van, like Karen Gillan and Matt Smith standing next to the ice cream van, or Matt Smith doing the thing with his Sonic or whatever. Yeah, I remember all that sort of stuff. And as well, I mean, that might be a good tangent to go on, actually. If I can find any of that stuff. But I remember a couple more things. So, like, I love the hell, I just like standing on boxes to get the extra height. Yeah, so two main memories from the filming of Series 5 and seeing it reported online. The main one was, like, I think the caves where they filmed the Angels two-parter. Obviously, for that story, they had loads of, like, props of statues and stuff to take down into the cave as, like, set dressing. And I'm pretty sure that I saw on some website, I don't even know if it exists anymore, but, like, there's a website where someone had taken photos of these these like props of like the angels, the what are they called, like the alpha attractions or whatever they're called, like the ones that have two heads but which are sort of meant to be actual statues but are actually weeping angels, those ones, and weird stuff like that. And people sort of snuck inside and taken photos of these things in wherever these caves were, which was interesting. And then also I think there was a bit with the Daleks which leaked as well. I'm trying to remember because I think I saw this recently actually. I'm going to go and find it, I think. I'm going to give it a go. Because I think it was on this website here. When it loads. Here we go, Doctor Who TV. Which these days isn't too great. But back in the day, there was a lot of really interesting stuff on here. About filming and stuff. But if we... if we try and head back on here... can find like find a old stuff from like 2010. Was it on here? Oh, maybe not. Okay, maybe it was on that. Maybe it was on the Doctor Who site again. Maybe on this one. Yeah, Cameron, that's what I'm thinking of. It was something to do with the Ironside Daleks. I think it was where they filmed on a rooftop for Victory of the Daleks, like where the bit where the Ironsides are unveiled. Let me just see if I can find it. I'm sure recently I saw something about this. Um, 2009, might be around here anywhere. Oh yeah, well there's some stuff here from 11th hour. Yeah, this is stuff that I remember. So like someone had gone onto the green where they were filming for Ledworth and like taken these photos of all the set dressing and stuff, so the fake duck pond, these bits here, so with like the post office and stuff, and yeah, then these photos of the ice cream van as well. Someone commenting after the episode's gone out, the monster was called Prisoner Zero and it was CGI. Yes, I think we all know that. But was there anything? There's definitely other stuff. I don't know if it was on this particular website. Oh, here we go. I think it was this. Yeah, here we go. It was this. So, yeah, it was here. There we go. It was like an image. So, obviously there, that is like the top of one of the Ironside Daleks. So they filmed on the rooftop of this building down in Cardiff somewhere. And this was on... 27th of August 2009 that this leaked. Series 5 filming continues with some new outdoor images. We won't say anything here, but so if you don't want to be spoiled, don't look here, as there is a fairly big spoiler image. So obviously you have these and you know, okay, fair enough, and you scroll down here and you have your Dalek sort of silhouette there, just the top of one of the Ironsides. But yeah, I don't think... that one as well. Churchill's dressing room. But I don't think, actually, that the actual design of the Ironside, like the full design of it, actually leaked. I think the first time we saw that was in the trailer where it was unveiled, like the second full trailer for Series 5 or something. I think. But yeah, I mean... that cracks me up looking back. That was like the closest thing we got to seeing what the Ironsides look like. Gotta love it. But anyway, where were we? We had done all of those behind the scenes photos, I think. So that was the 11th hour. Let us then move on to The Beast Below, the second episode of the series. The Beast Below. If you are enjoying this, please do leave a like if you haven't already. And please keep your memories coming of Series 5 and stuff, and all that sort of stuff in the chat. Your thoughts on these episodes. Lovely shot there to start us off. I don't think there is like an equivalent shot for the 11th hour. But yeah, it's like a sort of lovely like poster photo, like big promotional promo pic for this episode. Very, very nice indeed. And then what else have we got? We've got the behind the scenes photo there, just one behind the scenes photo this time. Oh yes, that's from the set, isn't it, of like the main market or whatever on Starship UK. Yeah. Sorry, all I can think of is looking at this, like, it is the fact that since this episode has gone out, I've read a load of stuff about like how troubled the production was for this story and how much it changed in post-production and stuff and editing and stuff like that. So, yeah, in fact, I think even Doctor Who magazine very recently did like a fact of fiction article about The Beast Below, where they were like, oh yeah, here's something that changed in the script, or here's something that changed in editing or whatever. And like, yeah, there were quite a few instances of that happening, like a whole subplot with Peter the Winder that just like was cut from the scene or like reshot or something, replaced with something else. So an interesting time. An interesting set as well, because we don't get a great sort of glimpse of this really. There's so many details and stores and things, obviously. But yeah, I guess that is just because they had so many problems with the footage that they shot on this set, and then obviously went back and like replaced it with other stuff instead. So yeah, it's a shame, but what can you do? Timmy there with the smiler. So yeah, the smilers. I remember, like I say, these being quite a big part of the early promotional push for Series 5. And yeah, I do maintain still that they are a pretty cool creation. Because I suppose they're not really a monster per se. But yeah, I think it's interesting and kind of ironic, like, looking back, how much they were in the promotion stuff and yet how little they actually feature in the episode itself. They're not really in it much at all, to be honest, like, especially towards the end with the Winders. And, yeah, it's a weird one looking back as well, like, to think that they kept Amy in her nightie for this adventure. Bit of a weird choice, you know, to have her in her nightie. Yeah, not sure they would sort of get away with doing that these days, really. It's a bit of a weird, weird one. Like, if it was a kid, like, if it was young Amelia in her dressing gown or something, then yeah, fair enough, but it is a bit sort of dubious, I think. Magpie Electricals, obviously. And yeah, you smile is there again. Right, I'm just going to go and get a very quick drink because my throat is very dry. I'll be back in just a moment. And we're back. So let's just catch up with the chat. Yeah, we've got a couple of comments about the stuff I was just saying. So, yeah, Hooven's Press for Extra, I think that does explain why we got a Peter the Winder figure, because originally he was going to feature more prominently in the story, I think, if I understood that right. And yeah, I got a couple of comments about the Smilers and people wishing they'd been used a bit more and stuff, and how it was a nice design. I think the design of the Smilers and of the Winders, you know, they're both pretty cool designs. And like I say, and like other people say as well, I just think it's a shame that they weren't used all that much in the story. But what can you do? What can you do? Well, I think these scenes as well in the belly of the beast, so to speak, are really cool and quite convincing as well. I know it's just like a pool of gunge and a bit of smoke and some red lighting and stuff, but yeah, I mean, it's a pretty cool effect. But I saw as well, we had a comment from Alex Evans about Music of Who. Thanks, Alex, for your comment and your enthusiasm about Music of Who. Alex says, really enjoyed your Music of Who series. How long have you been studying music? I haven't actually studied music like at university or anything or anything like that, but done it at school and stuff, and just, you know, it's always been a big part of my life, I suppose. So yeah, picked up a lot. I'd like to do more Music of Who stuff, but I don't know whether there's the demand for it necessarily. Maybe one day in some form, it would just require some thought, I think, about how to do that. But yeah, back to The Beast Below. Is it a good episode? I mean, I think it's an underrated episode. I think the fact that there was so much that went wrong or changed behind the scenes, you know, during production and afterwards, it does give it sort of an unfair, like, disadvantage. So I feel you sort of have to go into it with that mindset of, oh, you know, okay, this episode changed a lot. Things are a bit rough in terms of the production, and so just be grateful for what we did get, you know. And to be fair, there is some golden stuff in there in terms of the ideas and stuff, which does work really well and is really interesting. Like the whole concept of, you know, like voting whether to forget or to protest or whatever every 5 years or whatever it is, you know, all that sort of stuff is very interesting. And just the whole idea, this whole society where, you know, the United Kingdom has just sort of become this spaceship. A fantastic idea with so much untapped potential, really. I mean, hopefully one day Big Finish might get their hands on that, because that'd be a really cool spin-off series for Big Finish to do. Maybe give Liz Ten her own spin-off or something, and Hawthorne and all these characters, instead of, like, after the events of this episode, like, where the Starwell has been liberated and everyone's happy and there's no more stuff going on behind the scenes and secret conspiracies and stuff. Cameron, yes, that is indeed a Blue Sonic. Is indeed. Yeah, I'd sort of forgotten that myself, actually, as well. But yeah, for some reason, it was blue in the stomach of the Starwell. Liz Tan as well, fantastic character. Always loved her. Always thought she was really cool. Always loved it as well, like when she returns and Pandora opens, and she's like, you know, I'm the bloody queen, mate, or whatever, sort of a song. It's fantastic. It's absolutely brilliant. Love her. What a fantastic character. In fact, yeah, definitely. If Sophie Okonodo, I believe she's called, the actor, if she was up for doing a Big Finish box set, you know, spin-off, whatever, that would be so cool. So, so cool. Dr. Master, I love Doctor Who music. One of the Star Trek activities for my music class last week was to comment on Rebuilt from Resolution, as we're focusing on film music. Oh, wow, that's amazing. So you actually, like, got to study a piece of Doctor Who music in your film, in your music class. That's really cool. Awesome. What sort of stuff did they have to say about Rebuilt? I mean, obviously on the soundtrack, it's like, well, the Dalek theme in Resolution appears earlier in the episode, but in terms of the officially released tracks, it's like the first instance of it. Yeah, it's there a lot in that track, and it's a very interesting track, really, that one. Very good track. I mean, the whole score to Resolution is really cool. But yeah, I feel like Doctor Who music is a bit of a niche subject, and so it's just finding ways maybe to, like, make it a bit more accessible to people who don't quite have that same sort of investment in it as I do and other people might do, but not everybody, you know. Hooven Espresso Extra is saying, I'm surprised that Liz Ten wasn't a more recurring character like Dorian. Yeah, would have been nice, wouldn't it, if she'd cropped up a couple more times, you know, in this era, and I guess like Starship UK as a whole, that could have come back in Series 6 or Series 7 or whatever, and just, yeah, been part of the world of this era. That's a shame that didn't happen, I suppose, but like I say, in a big finish. I think I've been asked before, actually, like, you know, if you could pick one big finish spin-off to do from the new series that hasn't been done yet, you know, what would you do? And definitely, you know, thinking back to this episode and looking back at all these photos and stuff, and particularly the photos of that market set, there is so much untapped potential with Starship UK. So definitely, that is an answer that I would give. Like, maybe in the vein of the recent box that they've done for Peladon, for the sequel to the Peladon stories, the spin-off. Love this photo here of Matt. But yeah, do like a Starship UK, like Starship UK box set. All about the intrigue and politics of Starship UK and everything that's been going on. That'd be really cool. Aha, Joe Plum. The blue-white is that Sonic's torch mode. Thank you for the insight there. Great to have you here, and great to have you sharing your wisdom. Fantastic. So, victory of the Daleks. Victory of the Daleks. Yes. So, earlier I was talking about first of all, we've got this photo here, which is a bit more of a sort of general Series 5 photo, this one. But, earlier I was mentioning there's a photo that I saw on here that I had never seen before anywhere. And it is this one. Don't know where you found this one, Hooniverse Archives, but what a rare gem. What a fantastic photo that is of Dr. Amy and Churchill. Really, really very cool, that one. Piece of gold dust. So, and then we've got a few more of the Daleks, obviously, as well, actually. I think I know where you got these from. Was it the Hero Collector articles about the Daleks, I'm pretty sure. Different colour schemes. Although these two here, that one and that, are actually from Asylum of the Daleks. They're in the wrong place. You might want to move them. But yeah, on to the episode stills then. Very, very cool stuff. Okay, you didn't study the piece necessarily. Didn't go in depth. Yeah, I see. Very nice. Very, very nice. Well, always great to have Doctor Who crop up in any school lesson of any kind. That's always a great thing. Just noticed here, that Hooven Espresso Extra is saying, I think a lot of my nostalgia for this story, obviously meaning Beast Below, stems from the fact that Starship UK was used at the start of the Doctor experience in 2011. That is sort of unlocking a memory there for me, like half unlocking, because I haven't, well, before you said that, I have no recollection of that. And now I'm sort of thinking back and thinking, hang on. So I'm trying to think now how the Doctor experience, the original one, started off. I think I know what you mean. So, like, was it like you're in Starship UK and they had a load of props from like other stories and stuff? Was that where the whole thing began? I can't remember. Well, it would appear so from what you're saying, but yeah, it was like a decade ago, to be fair. So, Doctor Master, was the End of Time covered? It was not, no. I basically just decided to start tonight with Series 5, and then we'll come back to End of Time one day in the future, maybe. But for now, yeah, Series 5, fresh start. Matt Smith, Lamp Doctor. Because it just makes sense, really. But yeah, in terms of how much we're going to get through tonight, I'm thinking we'll maybe get to the end of the Angels two-parter and then call it a day there, I think. Because I don't want these streams to be like sort of like unwelcomingly long, if that makes sense. Like, you know, off-puttingly long to people that might want to watch them after the fact and look at it and go, you know, oh, it's a three-hour stream, not watching that, you know. I think, yeah, keeping them maybe to down like to hour and a half or something like that might be a better idea. So, yeah, I think we'll just go as far as like the Angels two-parter today, and then continue in the next stream with the rest of Series 5, or, you know, like a bit more of Series 5, and just do it in installments like that. It's probably like the easier thing to do, I think. But yeah, one thing that surprises me looking back at this story and the promo pics for this story is like how few photos there are, at least good photos, of the Daleks. It's like you get a few like this of the Ironsides, but none of them are really like particularly standout photos. And same for the Paradigms as well, as we'll discover. But so, I mean, some good ones are like the human characters. Just, I mean, that's probably like one of the better ones of the Ironsides. Obviously, with the tea tray, gotta love that. Gotta love the figure of that as well. Absolutely amazing. And to be fair, that one's quite good as well, but the Dalek is out of focus, so it's like, but with Churchill there in the foreground, those two, the team up. But yeah, in terms of this as a story, I think it's underrated. I think it really is. Obviously, the very fact of putting the Daleks into World War II is going to work, because the Daleks are a metaphor for the Nazis, so, you know, it works. And I love this design as well, like the green, sort of khaki green of the Ironsides. I love it. It's amazing. I remember, like, in the early Series 5 figure waves, how they were a big part of those waves. Obviously, they were the Dalek figure in those waves, and like, I just couldn't wait to get my hands on one, because, you know, they're amazing and still are. I mean, that's probably the best photo of them there, but it's not particularly well lit, but, you know. Yeah, Cameron pointing out that if we just go back to this photo here, yeah, that is of course one of the old sculpt 5-inch Dalek figures from character. Very, very nice indeed. Lovely to have that featured in the show. Where were we up to? I think we're up to Bracewell. Of course, this guy. Of course, as well, there were figures figures of Bracewell with his alternate hand and shoulder waistcoat, like chest piece as well. Yeah, I mean, that was a figure that no one asked for, but it's kind of cool nevertheless. But yeah, it is mad figure-wise to think of how many figures we have from this story. Like, there's obviously every Dalek, like the Progenitor Guard, the Ironsides, the Ironside with Tea Tray, all of the Paradigms. We've got Amy Pond and her outfit from this story, obviously. The 11th Doctor in his blue bow tie and shirt. The two versions of Bracewell. Winston Churchill as well. Like basically all of the main characters, which is quite rare for a story to have so many characters represented in figure form. But yeah, even these guys, I mean, it's a massive subject, isn't it? You know, like, the paradigm Daleks, a massive debate. But, like, I mean, I don't mind them. And I think even here, like, people say the colours are a bit too bright, they're a bit too garish, whatever. I don't mind it, really. You know, I think it looked pretty cool. At the time, I thought it looked pretty cool. I think it works. I really do think it works. Like, yeah, I can see why people didn't take to them straight away. But then it's also like, you know, come on, give them a chance. And I think you've got to admire this story for doing, like, basically the boldest thing that's happened with the Daleks since the show came back, like, before or since. I mean, certainly since this, we haven't had anything quite as bold. We haven't had, like, a proper redesign for the Daleks. Not, like, a full-on, full-time redesign. We've had, like, one-offs, like the Recon Dalek or the Defense Drones or whatever. Yeah, Hooven Express Rector is saying that Victory is probably only challenged by Pyramids of Mars for the story with the most figures that have been released. Yeah, no, you're right there. Like, Victory of the Daleks and Pyramids of Mars both spring to mind in terms of stories with the most figures. Okay, so I think all these ones are all screenshots, aren't they? I did notice Hooniverse Archive, this photo down here of the red Dalek doesn't seem to work. Like, if you click on it, nothing seems to happen. So maybe that's like a broken link there, the very last one on that page. But yeah, otherwise, I think that is all of the photos from that story. So let's move on to the Angels two-parter. Which again is surprising for this one, how few photos there are of the Weeping Angels that have been officially released. Very surprising. There was that one photo of, I don't know if I could find it these days, but like, if I type in like regenerating Weeping Angel, just comes up the figures, doesn't it? It was like this photo or a variation of it, which they released sort of in the run-up to Series 5, like Doctor Who Adventures and stuff, like the magazines, like, oh, here's a new type of Weeping Angel that's going to be appearing in the new series. And yeah, like, it's a shame we don't have more photos like this, you know, like, officially released, because I would love that. But yeah, what we've got instead is just like that one, basically, for this first part of the story, how on time of Angels. And I think that's the only one on this page that actually features an angel. And then in Flesh and Stone, there's like a couple of other ones, but you know. Yeah, it's just a bit surprising how few photos there are of the angels from this story that have been officially released. But these photos of the Doctor and Amy and the TARDIS are very nice. Very, very nice. Amy's first trip to an alien planet, of course, in this story. Who am I talking about? No, I'm talking about Dr. Master. Dr. Master says, what mythical creature would you like to feature in Doctor Who? I don't know how to answer that, really. I'll give it some thought. Nathan Exterm and M&M's. Nice to have you here, Nathan. Talking about the multicolored Daleks, have you seen the Joe Reeves video on them where they're a band and singing the Hello Again song from Scott Pilgrim versus the World? I can't say I have. If you want to send that my way, then I'll gladly give it a watch. But yeah, I mean, these photos as well from the beach set. I mean, of course, this was like Matt Smith's first day of filming on the show, or near enough. Like, these scenes were the first ones that he shot. It is very weird looking back at, you know, at these scenes and these photos and thinking how early on it was, you know, for him. And how he still just knocks it out of the park, you know. He's there right from the word go. Because, yeah, it was a strange choice to film this story first, even though it's like the fourth story to be broadcast. I don't know whether it's to do with like when Alex Kingston was available or some scheduling thing, or maybe Steve Moffat hadn't finished the script for the 11th hour or whatever, or Beast Below. I don't know, whichever other one it was shot with. What was it? Or maybe they were shot together, I can't remember. Was Beast Below shot with 11th Hour? Oh, never mind, I can't remember now. No, I think Beast Below and Victory of the Daleks were filmed together, weren't they? So which one was filmed with the 11th Hour? Was it Amy's Choice? I can't remember. Maybe it was. That's fine, actually. Let's take it to Google and find out. It's going to bug me now. Doctor Who Series 5... Doctor Series 5. It's not going to tell us that, is it? Oh, here it is, yeah. Oh, no, it's okay. The 11th hour is just in its own block. Okay. Fair enough. So, yeah, Time of Angels, Flesh and Stone was first. Then Beast Below, Victory of the Daleks. Then the 11th hour by itself. And then they filmed the Silurian two-parter then. Before Vampires of Venice and Vincent and the Doctor? And Amy's Choice? Well, I guess that was maybe to do with like the foreign filming, wasn't it, for those two stories. I guess Amy's Choice was the last one that they shot for this series. That is a mad thought, to think that they filmed the finale and everything else with Rory. And to think that they filmed Rory's death before the story where he actually comes aboard the TARDIS. Yeah, the order for that series is pretty bonkers. Like, these days, they do tend to keep things a bit more sort of chronologically ordered in terms of how they film them. Broadly speaking. But yeah, that is mad to think. Mad to think that it changed so much from the original order to what ended up on screen, in terms of how they filmed, at least. But yeah, Matt Smith's first day of filming. Yeah, that's fair, isn't it? Hooven Special Extra saying, I think they wanted to pull a Force Doomsday, of course, alluding back to the Fifth Doctor, and give Matt a chance to ease into the role before filming his first four episodes. Yeah, that's fair enough, I suppose, isn't it? I think now you say that is right. I've heard that before, I think. Yeah, I suppose it doesn't like have any negative like repercussions particularly. Like, you know, as I say, he's still brilliant in this story, gives a fantastic performance, but it's just like a slightly weird choice, maybe, like behind the scenes and in hindsight as well, to think that, you know, why didn't they just like film 11th hour first? Like, surely it would have been fine to just do that and then go chronologically. Yeah, I suppose having Alex Kingston there as well to help ease him in, obviously someone who's worked on the show before, yeah, you can sort of see why it happened. Um, Yeah, and Joe's saying that because these were the first episodes to be shot, there is a slight continuity error because Matt has longer hair in this story compared to other ones. Yeah. Oh, boy. I mean, that is a whole other subject of debate, isn't it? The length of the Doctor's hair and continuity errors and stuff, like Capaldi and Flatline. Oh, boy. Like, he literally films a couple of scenes, then goes away for a fortnight, has a haircut, then comes back and films some more. It's like, oh, nothing matches up from this footage to this footage, and it's mad. Anyway, yeah, there are some fantastic photos here of the cast in the caves. Just surprisingly few photos of the angels, sadly. I mean, presumably they do exist, just like locked away in the BBC somewhere, out of our reach. Father Octavian there. Sam's saying, Sam Anson gets happy with his Sam. Sam's saying, I'm amazed at how many costumes they had for Riversong, and then they chose the sheepskin outfit for her figure. Yeah, interesting choice, isn't it? I guess it's because they could do the two variants of it, and whenever they can do multiple variants of a costume and of a figure, then it's more financially viable because they can sell it to us twice. But yeah, it would have been nice to have her in her sort of army gear or basically anything else. Because that reminds, now you say that as well, actually, that reminds me, like, hold on, where do we get to just then? Yeah. In these scenes, like where she's in this gear and with this hair and makeup and stuff, I always thought, like, watching this at the time, looking at photos of her, looking at clips of her and stuff, I always find it quite hard to, I found it quite hard to sort of relate this version of River to the version that we knew from the library two-parter. I always thought she looked very different here, and just, yeah, it was a bit of a weird choice to make her look so different to how she looked in the library two-parter. Like, her hair is literally a different colour, she's plastered in makeup, just... Yeah, I don't know. I guess in theory it works because she's meant to be like slightly younger at this point in her life. But yeah, I always found that a bit weird because I guess like in her military gear, like in these scenes, and yeah, she does look a bit more like she did in the library story. But yeah, definitely not so much in these bits. With that as well, that's a fantastic shot there, Matt, isn't it? Fantastic stuff. I saw someone say, I think it was Hooven Espresso Extra. Yeah, I love Matt's hair in this one. The floofier, the better. I see where you're coming from. I do. I don't begrudge the fact that it's longer hair. Yeah, I know what you mean. But it's just such a good story, this one as well. It's such a good story, and Matt, you know, delivers right from the off. Like, you wouldn't know this was his first episode that he filmed, and just, it all works really well and builds to a fantastic cliffhanger. And it's so atmospheric as well, in the caves and stuff with the torchlight and everything. Uh-huh. Is that like a rare photo there at the end? I see it's been recently added. Interesting stuff. So, we will then just, I mean, Vampires of Venice, how much does that one have? Okay. Well, we'll do Flesh and Stone and Vampires of Venice, then call it a night for today. We will do that. Flesh and Stone, so obviously the second half of this story. lovely sort of poster for this one once again, poster art for it. Yeah, it's weird how like some episodes got this sort of like lovely poster treatment and some others just didn't, but there we go. Oh, crikey, we've got some comments in the chat. Let me just catch up with this. Matt there again. Ah, yes, I noticed as well, Universe Archive, this photo here is from Series 7, I'm pretty sure, like from The Angels Take Manhattan. So that as well is in the wrong place. When you have a moment to fix that, that needs fixing. So Joe is saying that on the first day of filming, Matt Smith split the Sonic in two. So the prop had to be altered to be a better build quality. And that is why the toy version of the 11th Doctor Sonic is so inaccurate. Wow, I don't think I ever knew that before. Thanks for that. So the toy is more accurate to how it was before it was altered because he broke it. Interesting. Yeah, and Emily's saying as well, it threw her off too. Yeah. Brown hair in the library, blonde hair ever since. But yeah, like you say, Nat, you're right, actually. Yeah, the brown hair and the look of River in the Library two-parter, ironically, that actually looks out of place now, given what we've had since. Yeah, no, you're totally right there. Sam says I could be wrong, but I remember reading somewhere that Matt Smith kept hold of those red high heels. It would not surprise me. That does ring a bell myself, I think. Yeah, so once again for this story, some lovely photos of the 11th Doctor and Amy, particularly in this like control room set for the spaceship. But like pretty much no photos of the Weeping Angels. I mean, there's that one, which is all right. There's that one, which again is okay. There is that one. That one there. Probably the best one, actually, across the two episodes. And that's the screenshot. So, yeah, it's literally just those three photos. Like, no official photos of the... Well, I suppose that's the closest you get to having, like, an official photo of the regenerating angel, different designs. No official photos of, like, the ones that are, like, completely, like, faceless and just, like, you know, corroded and everything. No photos of all these other Weeping Angel variants, which is a bit of a shame. Yeah, what can you do? Universe Archive, you're very welcome. Yeah, I'll happy point out anything if I see anything that's out of place. I mean, I don't envy the task you have of categorizing all of these photos correctly. But yeah, Sam's saying this story had some amazing cinematography. It gave a good horror vibe. It certainly did. I mean, that photo alone, like, it's just amazing. Very freaky and very much like a sort of like the whole story, like how they're sort of moving through the ship and being chased by the angels and having to go to different parts of the ship and, you know, like being cornered and stuff. It's very much like that sort of feel of like a, I don't know, like a sort of a fairground ride or like a ghost train or something, hasn't it? Like a roller coaster type thing where you're sort of constantly moving from one thing to the next. very high octane, very, very thrilling. Yeah, it's a great story. Great story. And again, like, as a kid, one thing I found a bit weird was the whole thing with the spaceship having its own forest. But looking back, I actually really like that idea. I really like it. And it makes total sense. Because, like, of course, like if you were going halfway across the galaxy somewhere, of course you want to have a bit of woodland to retreat into when things get a bit too much. And fill up oxygen as well and stuff. And keeping stuff going in that sense, in terms of the sort of scientific stuff with the composition of the air and everything. And photosynthesis. So that all makes total sense. And again, it's like one of those big Stephen Moffat sort of like wacky ideas of having something very natural on a spaceship, like merging those two things together and just saying, what the hell, let's go with it. And it offers such a lovely like colour palette as well, with the browns and greens, and then like a, you know, contrast obviously with the sort of the blues and greys of the control room here. It's very nicely done, very nice to look at. Just a great episode all around, actually, this one. A real instant classic, you know. Very, very good. I mean, apart from the final scene, obviously, but we don't talk about the final scene. Angel Bob, eh? Yeah, so creepy. So that was Flesh and Stone. Finally for tonight, The Vampires of Venice, then. Let's do that. Vampires of Venice. And we will pay tribute, as we do this, to Helen McCrory, of course, who played Rosanna Calvieri, I think she was called, in this story. Who, of course, sadly passed away a few months back. Sometime last year, I think it was, wasn't it? Great shot of Matt there. Love it. Absolutely love it. One of the best shots of him, I think, in character. From this year of the show. Oh, yeah, because there are a couple of rare shots here, actually. So there's this one, which I have seen before, of two of the vampires. But then, well, first of all, there's this one here, which I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's from the official website back in the day, from something I did on the official website. And then somehow you've sourced these ones as well, which are absolutely fantastic, of Matt in his blue bow tie and shirt, and yeah. I remember seeing these on like book covers and stuff, so it's amazing to see like, the original versions of them. Rubbing his hands together and everything. Fantastic photos. Great to have those. And Amy as well. I've never seen these before. Amy in her sort of Venetian gear, I guess you would say. And then one more of the vampires there, which is really cool. And I guess if you zoom in closely, you can probably see like where the sort of false teeth starts and like the real teeth starts and ends and all that sort of stuff. But yeah, we go. So on to the episode stills. But yeah, because yeah, he does wear the yeah. I was going to say I hadn't realised he wears the blue bow tie and shirt combo in this, but he does, doesn't he, of course. So this was an interesting one, actually, because I remember when this was on, quite a big thing was made about how scary the vampires were, and my sister at the time was only like 2, I think, and I think my mum had read an article about how scary the vampires were. And so my sister wasn't allowed to watch this particular episode, or at least not straight away. I think she watched it eventually, but you know, not when it was broadcast. And yeah, it's an interesting one. I don't think I've ever really properly thought of these guys as particularly scary, but I don't know, maybe fans that are a bit younger than me watching at the time would have been scared out of their mind watching this. So I don't know. It's not really for me to say that, really, but they are good baddies, I think. And of course, you know, Helen McCrory there is so good in this, so good. The first sort of proper antagonist for Matt Smith's Doctor to go face to face with. Well, I say that, I guess he gets Olivia Colman sort of in his first story, but her aside, this is like the first proper sort of top tier baddie for him to go against. And she is more than a match for him and him for her. And so it just works so well. So well. Hold on, I've lost my chat. There we go. And of course, we got a figure of Francesco the vampire, which I've got somewhere behind me, though I've lost the sword that came with it. So I keep meaning to get around to buying another one of those just to get the sword again. That'd be nice to have that in the collection. And again, it's one of those episodes, I suppose, like Fires of Pompeii. This is only the second time this has happened, like Fires of Pompeii being the first, this being the second, where they've actually been able to go abroad, in this instance to Croatia, I believe. And that really sort of lifts the profile of this story, I think, and really adds something, having all these old buildings and stuff and the architecture. Gives it a very different flavour, and definitely a sort of flavour that you wouldn't have been able to get if it had just been filmed in the UK, you know. One of the scary moments there with the vampire ladies. I think this was like the image that was used for the iPlayer listing of this story. Maybe it still is, actually. Yeah. The squad. I mean, the one thing I will say about this episode in terms of my thoughts on it is that the whole, like, the third act is really epic. Like, Matt Smith climbing up to this spire on the building, whatever it is, like this thing, like transmitter or whatever it is, and saving the day by like tearing it apart or something. But number one, the CGI is pretty shocking. Then number two, he just saves the day really, really quickly by like flicking a switch or something, and then suddenly all the grey clouds disappear, and like it's, oh, okay. Bit of an anti-climax, you know, in terms of how things just are suddenly fine. The stakes are like right up here, and then it just like all drops, you know. Yeah, but that's like the one thing I always think about this story. Like, I always think, oh, you know, I'm having quite good fun with this, and it's a, you know, it's a fairly harmless story, but fairly fun. And then you get to that climax, and it's a bit like, that could have been a bit better, you know. They could have spent a bit more time working on that. Yes, very Daleks in Manhattan, Sam. You're right there. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, here we go. Let us end on that photo there, rather fittingly, of Helen McCrory as Rosanna Calvieri in The Vampires of Venice. So, yes, I'm going to call it a day there for tonight's stream. We have got through 6 episodes of Series 5 tonight. We also made this... multicolored paradigm Dalek right at the start of the stream. I feel like I need to take a photo of that. Hang on, there's a tweet button here. Hold on, what's this? Oh, that doesn't work anymore. Okay. Oh no, hang on. It's opening up Twitter. I see. It's literally just a link thing. Never mind. I'll take a screenshot of this guy. Just so I've got a copy of it. And we'll perhaps do more of those in future. And then, yeah, in terms of the next stream, I guess on Sunday, again, the usual slot. Yeah, probably then we will resume Series 5 and do the second half of Series 5 at that point. So there we go. Red number one has just turned up. Why wasn't I told this was happening? Oh, apologies. I mean, all I can say is make sure you've got channel notifications and stuff on, I suppose. But yeah, that's all I can say. So, look, thanks for joining me, everybody. Please leave a like if you haven't already. And please subscribe if you haven't already as well. And you know, I always encourage people to check out my Patreon page, which will be linked in the description, or to do super chats or anything as well if you fancy that, but there's an obligation obviously. So yeah, we'll call it a day there. I'll sign off. Thank you for joining us tonight, and see you probably on Sunday for the next one, I think. Yeah, cool. Bye-bye.